smaller to the bigger is, no. Bigger to the whole is like the smaller, no wait. The whole is like the smaller, oh. You heard of the golden ratio, right? It comes with this symbol here, the Greek letter phi. And I'm pretty sure you heard that it's important for art, mathematics, architecture, and it shows up in nature. But this isn't so unique. You can say that about 2 to 1 or 3 to 2 as well. So what's special about it? I think the usual approach of giving the definition or finding examples where it shows up isn't going to work to answer that question. Let's instead imagine what it was like thinking about proportions and visual harmony before modern mathematics. What can we see from this angle? We are in ancient Greece. Our neighbor Euclid is writing about geometric elements. There are no calculators, also no decimal notation, and measurement units are based on body parts. That means it's not very practical to communicate precise lengths. But there is a roster of basic shapes, circles, triangles, other polygons, and there are techniques to construct them using a compass and a straight edge. And there are fractions, so you can have 2/3 of a finger and some clever ways of figuring out how much that is without getting hurt. So if we want to send a blueprint of a temple for someone to build, we can't just slap numbers on the sides. We have to describe proportions using known shapes and relationships. What this practically means is that a blueprint looks more like drawing instructions. It's lots of sketches with lots of descriptions. They're like recipes for achieving the same form we originally intended. Working like this really focuses attention on symmetry, harmony, and balance. Not only are those important if we want to create something beautiful and physically stable, but we also have to communicate those ideas to the people building it. If something is not clear, it's not like they can email us with questions. Knowing all of that, we ideally want to derive as much of our final shape as possible out of as few core principles as possible. This is already held by prior knowledge of basic shapes and geometry, but it's not enough. As soon as we leave the comfort of same-sidedness, we have to decide what proportions to use, and the choices we can make here are kind of arbitrary. We can find diagonals, transport lengths around, look for crossings, or we could use fractional ratios that look like they fit. There's hardly any logic or pattern to those choices, it's just trial and error. So let's talk about proportion. We want to end up with something as elegant and versatile as the regular shapes. Where do we begin? I'm going to use the shape of a vase for the general analysis of proportion, and to make it simple, I'm only going to focus on lengths we can measure along the vertical axis. There's the overall height of the vase, and if we divide it into two parts, there are also the heights of the bottom and of the top segment. Notice that once we've done that, we went from having only one thing, the height of the whole vase, to now having three things, top part, bottom part, and the whole. Before dividing, we could not talk about proportion vertically, since we only had one thing and nothing to relate it to. But after dividing, we right away get three proportions, top to bottom, bottom to whole, top to whole. And normally, if we make a cut in some arbitrary place, all three of those are going to turn out different. If we want to come up with a system of regular and well-behaved proportions, the ones we choose should not explode into randomness like this. We want some symmetry that sticks around when we combine and manipulate the different pieces, like a kind of similarity between them. Alright, so we should look for ways to split this vase, such that we end up with some of our three proportions related to each other. And to start, we will look for cases where at least two of them are perfectly equal. The first example is quite simple, we split the vase in half. Then of course the top and bottom parts are equal, but that's not what we want to look at. We want to look at the two proportions that are now equal, top to whole and bottom to whole. They both relate as 1 to 2. And comparing the pieces to each other is different, they relate as 1 to 1. We can see what this property means if we keep splitting parts in half. Every piece we get stays kind of related to the previous bigger one. It works, but it's also boring. Let's look for another example. What if we wanted to split the vase in two different parts, but still get the similarity of proportion going on? We know that it has to be somewhere in these two zones, and in fact, the spot does appear in both of them. These two are the same though, just the other one upside down. Okay, let's pick the first one. It aligns with the actual shape of our vase better. We are again going to focus on proportions that match. They will be top to bottom and bottom to whole. But we cannot compare them like this, so we need to scale the first proportion up. Now we can see that we have the same relationship on the left and on the right. And moving the dividing line up and down shows the sweet spot we need to find to have this property. What this practically means is that we have one scaling factor to rule them all. One factor to get us up from the smallest part all the way up to the whole, and of course back. It's always this same pattern. And that magic factor, that is what is called phi, the golden ratio. But wait, this is just one fancy way to split something into two parts. How does this help us when we want some other proportion? Weren't we looking for a whole system? Yes, and this is where the golden ratio really shines, pun very much intended. See, if we want to find some other proportion, we just subdivide using the same cut. Let's start up here. We can do it with the bigger part below the smaller part like before, or we can reverse direction and have the bigger part on top and smaller below. Just for fun, let's also cut the bottom part, this time in both directions. So bigger above and then bigger below. Alright, looks like we now have a rainbow of proportions. But if we look more closely, lots of these parts are the same size. So let's color them again, but this time use the same color for parts of the same size. We start with the smallest, and it appears only once. Then we move on to the next bigger one. It appears three times. The next one is a bit tricky. It shows up twice here, but it also shows up as two parts together here. Let's shift it to a copy of the vase. What about the next one? Let's copy the vase right away. We get our original top back, and then we have these two overlapping parts at the bottom. And lastly, we have our original big bottom part, and its reflection here. So we got an abundance of harmonious proportions, all related to one another, that just magically pop out of one simple rule. Even some splitting in half shows up. And now, we bring them all together, clean up a bit, and voila, not a bad result for using only one factor. This concept turned out to be all the rage for Greek artists and architects for many centuries, and it was never forgotten to this day. This day when we're asking ourselves if it's really special. Is that even controversial? It seems to be a bit. A lot of the controversy comes from claims that a work of art or something in nature follows the golden ratio, and it later turns out that's not really true, or the evidence is a bit inconclusive. In fact, it's very likely that most places where you can find it, no one put it there intentionally. That's very clear in case of nature, but it's also true about human creations. The vase I've picked to do these demonstrations is a good example. I didn't set out to find one that resonates with the golden ratio. I just found and traced an elegant one, and it turned out to do so naturally. To some degree, this is a happy accident. Of course, there were many shapes to choose from where this would not have happened, but it's also not surprising that it just worked. The golden ratio is in many ways a very natural sweet spot. Not too big, not too small, just right. Do its unintentional appearances make it less special? I don't think so. It has to be pretty special to just magically manifest in everything from flowers to temples, and it speaks of its nature being very close to the foundation of our reality. Just like pi. You can make a circle without ever having heard about pi. Nature makes round things without thinking about it. But once a round thing is there, so is pi. There are many details we haven't touched on here, such as where this mysterious connection to splitting in half comes from, and what it is about phi that makes it so pervasive in all things harmonious, but I'm gonna leave those as appetizers for future videos. Please tell me what you think I should address in those videos, subscribe if you want to know when they come out, and let me know in the comments how this one was for you. I hope you enjoyed and learned something new. Bye!